Welcome, friends, to this great event that we are celebrating in these few days. In a couple of days, we'll be ready to celebrate the Bhandara of great master Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji. The great master initiated me on the 9th of March, 1936. Long time back. I was talking to a friend of mine a few minutes ago who completed today 30 years of initiation. And I asked, what have you to show for this initiation? I said, I have been initiated for more than 80 years. I don't know what I can show for it. And that friend of mine reminded me that in 30 years, the events of life have convinced her what a master means and has given her unshakable faith. And then I realized that that's exactly what happened to me. That in 80 years, with so many life's ups and downs, all kinds of events happening in my life, good and bad, high and low, but one thing that came through during this period was a faith in my master which cannot be destroyed by any changes in life, whether they are up or down. If our faith is based upon what is happening in life, if good things happen, we have faith. So bad things happen, we lose faith. That is not the kind of faith that is generated by an initiation by a perfect living master. What he generates is a faith in who he is. By several events, some internal and some external. Internal events are some successful sessions of meditation where you can see things inside, hear sounds inside, be transported to other worlds inside, have some experiences which make you feel there is a greater reality, bigger than the physical reality we're living in. And very often, completely forgetting these experiences when we come out of meditation. And yet, the effect of that meditation remains on us. These are the kinds of things that happen over time. And then we realize that who we have met, the great master, the perfect living master, looked like an ordinary person, but was not ordinary at all. No matter how much we describe a perfect living master, I feel it's so difficult. According to one mystic, it's impossible to know a master. You can never know a master fully. You cannot help but think he's another human being, because he is another human being. All your evidence, all your sensory perceptions show a perfect living master to be an ordinary human being. He functions exactly like us, no difference at all. He's born like us, dies like us, falls sick like us, takes medicines like us, eats food like us. Then where's the difference? He has arguments with his wife generally. We all happen to have the same kind of experiences. Then where is the difference between a perfect living master and ourselves? How can we see any difference? And yet something happens. If we get initiated by such a person, as we go on interacting with that person, we find there is something more in that person than we can see. We cannot always know what that something more is. But whatever that more is, it draws us to him or her in a way that our mind cannot explain. If I were to use language to describe that, I would say it's a pull that comes from a perfect living master that pulls us. And The only words I can use is, it is from pure love of a master for us. I have no other words to tell you how that pull comes. But we like to be more and more with that master. We like to spend more time with that person. We like to have just look at that person, just have his darshan. It's a very strange feeling that how you are being pulled without anything so significant happening. Small things happen, we begin to call them miracles. Then we tell other people, oh, a miracle happened. I got into an accident and nothing happened to me. Car was totaled. It was a miracle. And the friend says, car was totaled, was it a miracle? He couldn't save your car. What kind of master is he? And we forget the totaling of the car and we are calling it a miracle. Same thing which somebody else says, a serious accident. You lost your car and we are saying it's a miracle. And we say it seriously. And we begin to believe it was a miracle. Where is this coming from? And then not only we believe it was a miracle, we write to Master, Master, thank you for saving me. How did Master save? We go to Master and say, Master, thank you, you saved us from that wonderful, great miracle you performed when the car was smashed and totaled. Nothing happened to us, we just walked out. And Master says, when did the accident happen? Where did it happen? As if he knows nothing about it. If he knows nothing about it, how are we feeling he knows? And when he denies, as if he knows nothing about it, we still feel he knows everything. These are such extraordinary experiences. No rational explanation. No logical explanation for this. The mind cannot understand it. Mind tries to understand and fails. Mind can create doubts, which interferes with our faith. So the mind is performing a certain function. It creates doubt. It's not doing something incorrectly. It's designed to do that. Mind is a machine, a computer-like machine given to us, attached to our consciousness. And when we use our mind, we use it by thinking. The most common use of the mind is thinking because it is thinking all the time anyway. Its lifeline is dependent upon thinking. We say we are breathing, therefore we are alive. Our heart is beating, circulation is going on, therefore we are alive. We can also say, the mind is thinking, therefore it's alive. If it stops thinking, it'll die. Therefore, thinking is natural to the mind. In this thinking process, which is the main function of the mind, it uses that function for many things. It uses that function for trying to understand things. How does it understand things? We have delegated experience of a creation to our sense perceptions. Eyes to see, ears to hear. In this body, we have these sense perceptions. Nose to smell, mouth to taste, hands to touch, legs to walk. All these five senses that operate upon the physical body, they are the ones that give us knowledge and experience of a creation outside, a physical creation. They are the same sense perception that can give us a experience of non-physical creation, like imagination. When we imagine things in imaginary state, we can also see things, we can hear things, we can touch, taste and smell also. So therefore, the sense perceptions are giving us knowledge and awareness of this physical world. But do these sense perceptions make any sense of their own? No. Let me give an example. I look at these beautiful flowers. They are really beautiful. I can touch them. Oh, I can smell them also, even from a little distance. Beautiful flowers. Where did I know that they are beautiful flowers? Did my eyes say? they're beautiful flowers? Did my hand say they're beautiful flowers? Did any sense perception say they're beautiful flowers? Not at all. My eyes saw shapes and colors. That's all. My hands touched something that had a tactile sense, something solid. Apart from that, I could not think of beautiful flowers till the thinking mind made them beautiful flowers. So thinking mind is performing a big function. And if I tell you great details, you'll be surprised. When the eyes see something, they are seeing colors and shapes. They cannot see anything more than that. They are just seeing colors and shapes all around. Ears can hear sounds. That's it. They cannot hear language. They cannot understand anything. When we use our eyes and ears, how do we know what a person is saying? How can we know these are beautiful flowers? It is because the mind interprets them based upon a very good reservoir it has called memory. It is remembered that when we grew up as children and we saw the flowers, somebody called them flowers. That got stuck in our mind. And therefore, we saw many types of flowers. Every time different flowers came, they used the same word flower. The meaning of the sound, flowers, became deeper and deeper as we saw many flowers. But this is just an association of ideas of the memory. We stored the memory that the word flowers means that particular experience of seeing these things, that shapes and colors that called flowers. And that kept on repeating as we saw more and more of the same thing. Every experience we are having is interpreted exactly the same way. The association of ideas with those experiences has generated language. What we heard, the sound that we heard, they constituted language based upon the association of ideas we had in the stored in the memory of the mind. So mind has a reservoir attached to it called memory, where it stores these things and uses that memory to interpret new experiences. Now, another interesting thing, which will be understood by people who meditate. It's not something philosophical. The mind, when it thinks, it speaks. We hear it. If it did not speak, we would never know what we are thinking. Then, if the mind speaks, who hears? Who listens? We listen, the self listens, the soul listens, our real self listens. Our real self is nothing but a listener. It's an amazing experience. The mind is the speaker, the soul is the listener all the time. When we see flowers, the mind in a very short time says, this shape and color are flowers. When it says that, we listen and the word flowers becomes an experience of flowers. This is happening inside. Through meditation, you will see that all thoughts are speech. When we speak outside, like I'm speaking to you now, it's again the mind speaking. And my tongue is just uttering what the mind is thinking and speaking. So thinking process is actually the mind speaking. So it's very interesting. Why I'm emphasizing this is because those who do not know the distinction between our real self, the soul, and the mind that thinks, they have an opportunity now in meditation to listen to the mind and realize you are not the mind. The mind can also use the sense perception of vision, not the vision with these eyes, the inner vision with the imagination. The inner vision draws pictures in front of the mind. And we can see that the mind is using the same process of interpreting the inner visions as it interprets the outer visions. It's a great exercise. for understanding the difference between the mind and the soul, the mind and your real self. Because spiritual path that we are following is nothing more than discovering your own true self, your highest self, the reality of yourself. If you can find who you really are, you have discovered everything, including God who created us. You can find answers to all your questions if you can find who you are. Socrates said, know thyself. All others have said, discover your reality within yourself, not outside. There is no power sitting anywhere outside that can do anything what you can do from your real self inside. These are remarkable experiences that we get on the spiritual journey. Great Master's teachings were very simple. He said, what you see outside is inside. One great master said, Bahar bhitar ekho jano. What is outside is also inside. We go further. What is outside is being created outside because it is inside. This is a little more difficult to understand. That the world we are seeing outside would not be seen by us through sense perceptions if it wasn't inside us. Therefore, it's a projection we are having. The analogy I sometimes give of going to see a movie. We go to see movies. They become very popular now. And we buy tickets. We pay a price for going and watching a show taking place on a blank screen. There is nothing on the screen at all. But a projector is behind us. A film made much earlier. Not at that time. A film made much earlier is loaded into that projector. And there's a light put behind that. And the film made of short still pictures, which run one after the other very quickly, create a feeling of motion, movement, because of the persistence of vision of our eye. That if things move very fast, even if they are still pictures, they look like moving. When we were little children, they used to give us a little book with different pictures. We used to flip them fast and we saw all the movements. There is nothing different in today's movie. Every picture is a still picture moving fast and we see it like movement. We are not looking at that. We are not looking at the light. We are not looking at the projector. We are not looking at the film loaded into it. We do not know when it was shot. We are looking at the screen in front, which is blank. On the blank screen, images are coming. And we are taking them to be real. A serious crisis has come. Somebody is going to be murdered on the screen. We sit on the edge of the chair. Somebody cracks a joke on the screen. We laugh as if it's really happening. What is happening? Nothing but shadows. Nothing but a projected shadow. And we are looking intensely at the screen. Why don't we say, oh, this is not real. It's only a film being projected. Why are we taking it so seriously? Why did we have to pay a price to come and see it? Just to see shadows? We are seeing so much reality outside. Why do we pay a price to come and see shadows? This question was raised long ago. Why are people wanting to see shadows? Why are people wanting to see imitation of life when they are already living a life? When we are living our life, where is the necessity to go to a movie and get happy about it? After seeing some murders and horrible accidents on the movie, we are happy. And we come out happy. Oh, great movie. Big tragedy, but great movie. Can we say that about life also? How come when life is represented on a screen through shadows, we say great, when the same life is happening in our own life, we can't call it great. With the same kind of things happening. The Greek philosophers went into this question. And they gave different answers. Socrates, who believed that everything is inside us, and he said so. In all his debates, he says, it's all a projection from consciousness within our head. Therefore, we should find what is inside. We should find ourselves. That was his whole theme. His disciple, Plato, another Greek great philosopher, he intellectualized this. He intellectualized it and trying to explain it in terms which people could understand outside. Plato said, what Socrates means is that the ideas we are having in our head are more real than the things you see outside. And he gave an example. He said, you are sitting on chairs now. We call them chairs. Chairs are of thousands of designs. Every one of them is called a chair. Where did it come from? How do we call a chair when there are so many thousands of types of chairs? We use one word. What is the idea of a chair? Where did it come from? He examined this based upon Socrates saying that everything is inside, and he came to the conclusion the idea of a chair came before a chair could be made. Therefore, the idea of a chair is more real than the chairs we make, because without that idea, you couldn't make it. And the idea of a chair is inside your head, not outside. He said, before the idea of a chair came, something must have come even before that. So he began to differentiate between ideas and what he called concepts. A concept comes, then an idea, then a material physical presence. He called them the causal, the astral, and physical levels of creation. The concepts come in what we call the causal level of the mind. That means people were all sitting on the floor. The concept that we can sit higher if we like came up. It is not a chair. It is merely a concept that can't we sit higher up? It's better for our legs. Maybe it is better. Then the idea came, we can make something. We can make a material thing which can be higher than the ground, and we can call it a chair. We can rest our arms and make an armchair. But we can make a chair, and one chair came into the head as an idea. All the millions of chairs today are born out of that one idea of a chair. Therefore, Plato said, it's the idea that creates the chair. Then ideas are more real than this physical world. It wouldn't exist. Nothing would be here if we didn't have the idea. Chair was just an example of everything. It can apply to everything we are watching. Then comes another disciple of Plato and Socrates named Aristotle. Aristotle wanted to bring it down to the ground. He said, you people are talking of high stuff. People don't understand. The Athenians have no idea what you're talking about. Tell them something practical. Tell them, why are we creating this artificial world? And he took the example of a drama. There were no movies in those days. Movies are a modern invention of the old drama that used to take place on a stage. So when he took the example of a drama, he said, people are acting on the stage. They are not real people. They are just people picked up from outside and given certain characters. A king on the stage, maybe a barber outside. And sometimes the kings in the early plays used to sharpen their razor as a king also. They used to forget that they are kings. But a good actor would not, even as a barber, would not rub his razor out on the screen when he's acting on the stage, when he's acting as a king. So therefore, a pretended act, acted act, not real, was part of the drama. But the people watching said there's a real king. The king killed his queen, and people cried. They forgot that there is no killing at all. It's just an actor. The wife has not died. The queen has not died. She's just fallen down as an act. And people cried. What cruel this king was. Why did they take something which was merely a show, merely an idea put into place? Why did people take it so seriously? Why did they forget that this is just an act? It's a very big question he raised, because he then comes to the conclusion that the act that we are playing here as characters, we are also taking it as real. We are no different than the people of Athens who took a drama on the stage as real while they were watching it and emotionally responded to it, laughing and crying depending upon what the actors were doing. Tragedy took place, they cried. Comedy took place, they laughed. We do the same things today with movies. How can we do that if we know this is just a movie, just a shadows being thrown by a light and pre-prepared film loaded in a projector? Why are we doing that? He came to the conclusion that we need this. Human beings need this experience to make that unreal thing into real, to take care of their emotions. Human beings have been gifted not only with an awareness of the self, of the mind, of the body, but also an awareness of the situation in this game we call life, in which emotions play a very important role. And the reactions we have on watching a movie, or the reactions they had on watching a play, is to deal with emotions of a human life. That we are unable to handle emotions of what we think is real unless we create an artificial reality and deal with those emotions. And therefore, we willingly suspend our disbelief. That's what Aristotle said, that when we watch drama, which will be true to say when we watch movies, while we're watching them, we willingly suspend our disbelief of what is happening. We say it is actually happening. This is a need which the mind provides so that we can get rid of the excess of our emotions. He called it catharsis of emotion, that we have to deal with our emotional life, and therefore we need a reality created out of non-reality. If you understand this old Greek philosophy, you understand the same is true today. Who are we actually in this created drama? How is it being created? Let's compare it with how the movie is created. There's a blank screen. There's a blank space and time here. We project something which was made earlier. We are projecting a life which was made earlier. How are we projecting? With a little projector, our head, our body. Where is the light? Our soul is the light. Our self is the light. Where is the film? Where is the film loaded? In the mind, in front of the soul. How is it being projected? The mind is carrying the film of the life that we recorded earlier, completely recorded. And how are we seeing it? On the screen, outside, and by a subtle arrangement, we made it a multi-dimensional screen, which is not very difficult. They are making 3D movies now, just by putting extra glasses. We have been given those glasses naturally by giving two eyes. If we had only one eye, we would not see space and time like we see now. We have been given two ears. They are creating space and time, ears and eyes, If he had one ear and one eye, world would be very different, would be flat. It became multidimensional, three-dimensional, four-dimensional. Time has been created by the mind. So it's a wonderful way. A new type of screen has been created on which we are projecting something with our own light. And through the memory of a film recorded earlier, a life made earlier and completely recorded. And when it is watching, when we are watching the movie or living this life, we say, now what will happen next? We say that in the movie, we say it here. Don't we know that what is going to happen next is already in the film? Don't we know that what is going to happen is predetermined and will happen anyway? Doesn't it happen like that? Therefore, we are making the same mistake, deliberate mistake, in order to achieve the same results, to take care of the emotional side of a human life. It's very simple. So we are using the same method in a much bigger scale of a creation that is so wide. That's a big screen. We are seeing it in the biggest screen we can create. The whole universe is a big screen. And all we are watching is being projected from inside us. All the people we see are already inside us. All the acts we see is inside us. Now, is this just a theoretical model these Greek philosophers made? Or is it something verifiable? That's a very important question. Maybe the world is real and we are just here sensory perceptions to watch what is there. Or maybe they were right, that the whole thing is inside and being projected the way they say it's being projected, like a movie. How can we finally find out what is true? Not a new question, but thousands of years people have said, do we see a tree because we see it is there, or is the tree there, therefore we see it? Which is the cause? Which is the effect? Is the tree the cause or seeing the cause? Not a new question. They've asked for thousands of years. They've divided themselves into two parts. Those who say a tree has to be there before you can see it. This world has to exist prior to your being able to experience it. We call them the materialists because they believe material is real. Matter is real. And those who believe in the Socratic theme or the Platonic idea that the world of ideas is more real, they say, no, it's all being created from your consciousness inside. And they are called idealists. The debate between the materialist and idealist has been going on for a long time. And they are using their mind, using their thinking. Both sides are arguing, not coming to any conclusion. But neither side is realizing that if we want to understand something, is it happening from inside or not, why not go inside? If it is happening outside, go outside. Outside we are here already and we are seeing what is happening. Let's go inside and see the other side. That's the simple answer. They don't go inside. If the answer is so simple that you say, is things happening inside creating the world, or the world is outside, therefore you are experiencing it? You have seen the world outside, it is there. Now go inside and see if it is there also. See if the real world from which the outside is a projection is actually there or not. This is the best answer. If it is there, you validate the idealist. If nothing is there, then you validate the materialist. It's a simple matter of going within your own self, not somebody else. No lab is needed, no science facility is needed. You just have to go inside your own head, from where you are seeing everything with your eyes, ears, everything from inside. Therefore, they said, let's try. They closed their eyes. Idealist sitting here, materialist sitting here, both have closed their eyes. Materialist says, I see nothing but darkness. Open the eyes, oh, is it real? The idealist says, I am imagining so many things inside. I can see chairs, I can see people, I can see that. I see a lot of things. You didn't see anything. The materialist says, I saw darkness. He said, but in the darkness, didn't you see anything else? I saw so many things. Oh, that was all imaginary. You are calling your experience imaginary. That is not real. This is real. The idealist says, but when I saw those things, I could see the colors and the shapes. I could hear the sounds. I could touch things. I could use the same sense perceptions you are using to see this world. Where is the difference? You explain to me the difference in the sense perceptions. Do you have any other means, Mr. Materialist, to see this world besides your sense perceptions? If you have, come and tell me. Materialist thinks, I don't have any other means. If all my sense perceptions are lost, I can't know anything about the world. To that point, you are right. But my sense perceptions are located on my body. If I close my eyes, I can't see. Then I open my eyes, I can see. The idealist says, well, I can see with my closed eyes. You call it imaginary, but it is seeing. There is no difference in the vision. How can you deny that the sense perceptions are existing independently? And by the way, Mr. Materialist, do you dream at night? Of course I have dreamed. Do you see in them? Do you see with eyes open or closed? You are sleeping with your eyes closed and you are seeing in dream. You are running around in the dream. You are touching things. You are doing everything that you do with your sense perceptions. Are you not aware? This debate goes on. The guy with the idealist says, okay, I will tell you something. Let us stay with the imaginary sense perceptions for a while and see what happens. He says, I am not going to waste my time on that. Okay, I will do that. The idealist then says, I will stay with my imagination. I will see how far I can imagine things. I am imagining the whole world. I am imagining everything. And as I am imagining that I am inside imagining, I am forgetting things outside. Because the imagination is pulling my attention inside. And as the attention is being pulled inside, I am getting more and more engrossed in my imagination and seeing those things. I am forgetting where I am sitting because I am thinking, or like a dream, I am now creating a dream in imagination, but more real because I am still awake. I am still using this imagination while I am awake and I am seeing so many things. And I'm seeing and doing so many things there inside, I forget where I'm sitting. I forget if I have a body. Then who am I? If the body is not part of me, who am I? That means the one that is feeling that it can see, it can touch, it can smell, it has all sense perceptions. It also has consciousness and awareness. It is living. It's not something, a picture outside. I am having this experience. It's my experience. It's the experience of the self. Can I have more experience than that? To understand more if I am more than merely imagination? What if I were to now do the same thing I started off by closing my eyes? Materialist closed his eyes and saw nothing but darkness. I saw imaginary things. Can I close my eyes in my imaginary self and see what happens? Close the eyes of the imaginary self inside. A new world is opening up. Is it my imagination now or something else? I can start seeing the building blocks of my sense perceptions. I can see life patterns being drawn. I can see the drawing board where they make life patterns. I can see the what we call the destiny of life actually being filmed there. This is where the actual thing took place. And through that imaginative self, through the physical self, through physical level of awareness, I was able to see. That is where the source of all creation is. The idealist says, I have found proof. I have found the proof that this world is nothing more but a projection of my own self. The materialist, who was tired of this discussion, now wakes up. He says, it's all made up by your imagination. There is no such place inside the imagination. He said, why don't you try? I am not going to waste my time. But the one who tested it out was able to find out that everything that happens outside, the building blocks of that, could be actually experienced and seen inside. We call that process of withdrawing attention inside as meditation. Great Master's teaching is simple. Go step by step inside yourself and get answers to all your questions. And it works. It's as simple as that. No need to go anywhere else. Go only within your own self and you discover everything. We call this state of experience a physical experience. A sthul, physical, because it is made of matter, physical matter. It's made of atoms and molecules and things like that. It's made up of stuff that science is also getting bewildered when they find some strange phenomena here. The strangest phenomena that's going to play a big role in the next 20 years, you'll see, is discovering that we who are seeing a real world are changing part of that world by looking at it. Now that's too terrible for those materialists. If observation can change something here, terrible. If it can change in imagination, okay. But if it changes physical things, terrible. Physical things are defined as existing in the form of energy and matter. Everything can be divided into energy and matter. Great scientists like Einstein said that we can convert one from the other, but their totality is the same. The total volume of energy and matter is the same. Sometimes the matter is existing in the form of energy, sometimes becomes matter, and when it becomes matter, it creates space. And time. When more matter is created, it creates more space and time and begins to curve it, create a curvature, bends it. And ultimately, he said, I look at this world, so much matter has been created, it's created a curvature in space all around, and that is the secret of gravity. But he was not sure of it. Even today, people are not sure of what gravity is. They're still trying to figure out if Einstein was right or he was wrong and there is some dark energy and dark matter that are making gravity, because the world is spinning round. Everything is spinning. While I am talking to you, can you imagine we have traveled several million miles already? How did we travel without even moving anything? Because the earth moved around, moved on its own axis. And it moved around the sun. The sun is moving around the whole galaxy. The whole galaxy is moving. And all the galaxies are also in circulation. The observation. It's been seen there. We just moved a few million miles without even knowing about it. We are moving at a speed faster than the velocity of light, according to latest readings. And we don't feel it at all, this movement. Why are things going circular all the way? All the way. Everything. Starting from the smallest particle of matter we call the atom, where electrons are moving around it. Now they know electrons are moving on their own axis also. And particles smaller than electrons, the quarks and neutrinos, are all moving around. Why is everything moving around? No explanation. Oh, gravity makes them move. If gravity is so important, where does it exist to make all galaxies move? These are modern questions being asked today by the scientists, and they are trying to find answers. If you are a scientist and are studying that, you will find more information about it. If you want to find ready answers to these questions, I'll give you a tip, go within. You'll find out what is happening. You will find out what will happen 100 years from now, what they will find out. This whole question came up because of some guy named Heisenberg. He discovered the nature of light. Light was a very important subject because people said when you get wise, you become enlightened. When you realize how the world is created, you are enlightened. The word light has been used a lot. And also people say when your eyes are closed, you can, if you are enlightened, you see light inside, physical light inside. So the word light has been very important consideration for people throughout history. Now, what does light consist of? What's the unit of light moving which they can now take a picture? They call them photons. I'm just bringing little science today because I won't bring any on Bhandara Day. Photons are moving, and are they energy or are they particles? This was the question that was raised 50, 60 years ago, and they did some experiments. If you put the light through two holes, one beam of light will go through both holes. If you look at it, it'll go through one. If you go through two holes, it'll create a pattern of waves on the screen. It's a wave going through, photon is a wave. If you look at it, measure it, it becomes a particle. Human beings are able by their observation to convert something that was energy or a wave into a particle. They did not know what to call it. Should we call it wave? No, it can be particle. How can you call it wave? Is it a particle? No. How can you call it particle? So they found a new word for it. They called it quanta. Quanta defined, it is simultaneously a wave and a particle, and it can be used as a wave and a particle. The only interference to make wave into particle is human observation. It's a very big thing. If you see the last notes that Einstein left before his death, he recorded these notes there, that I have not been able to pay enough attention to the great power of an observer, that the observer has so much power, I did not realize, and therefore I should have worked more. But he never got time and he died. This has puzzled people that this quanta, which started a new physics, quantum mechanics became a new physics, and they are now wondering, where can we use this? They tried to explain to layman. Layman is, there is a cat in my bag. It can be alive or it can be dead. You tell me, is it alive or dead? Until you open the bag, it can be alive and dead, both. It's a quanta. When you open, it will be either alive or dead. Mostly dead. It's been locked up too long, therefore a particle. These are the kinds of explanations they're trying to give for lay people. But the problem has arisen that this has been experimented again and again, again and again, and the quantum physics has come to stay. That human observation can change a particle, a wave into a particle. And because of this, they are coming up with something which you might have a chance to use. Younger people will definitely have a chance to use, called quantum computers. The current computers which we are using and the computing power that's in our phones is all based upon digital technology, which was a big thing. That everything that you see here in this world, including vision, sound, even thoughts, can be recorded in two digits, 0 and 1. How is that possible? It's possible because we have electric power that moves, electromagnetic energy available is used as electricity, and we can generate a circuitry in which we can pass electricity. If it passes, we can call it one. If it doesn't, we resist, call it zero. So digital language is actually not two digits, it's one. One and not a, and no one. Zero is merely the absence of one. So when they designed these circuitries, they found they could create anything. Today, we are hearing music through our computers, through our phones. We are seeing visions. We are talking to people on Skypes and so on. All because of digital technology. Zero or one. We have to plant the zero or one to make digital technology. We can plant it either through the system of circuitry in which we use resistance and conductivity as zeros and ones, or we can program it into a typewriter type of thing where you can type these different combinations of zeros and ones, make letters, language, music, anything through this combination. Strings of these can be made up and make everything that you are seeing in the world can be made of digital technology. What will happen in computer technology when that is used? We will have quanta, which they found a new word for that. Qubits. No digits. No zero or one. We'll be using qubits. What's a qubit? Both zero and one. What will make it zero or one? Human observation. They are designing, they are working very hard that do we need external measurement or external observation to create it, or can it be mental observation? They've just experimented recently that they can exchange mental thoughts of different people with each other through some technology, and they will use that. So future computers will type out your messages, create music by your thoughts. Can you imagine? You'd be experiencing it. It's unbelievable today. It can be done. More and more you will find the power of what is inside us, which is creating what is outside. These are remarkable developments taking up in science today. So that science will be hit by a block, that it can go nowhere unless it accepts some bit of metaphysics which has been there for thousands of years. So that people who don't want to go inside, the materialists, they will have the chance to say, how can I move forward understanding this quantum mechanics that's going on, quantum computers, how are they working? And he will probably say, let me also meditate. I don't know if any of you knew that Einstein meditated. And he said a lot of the inspiration came through meditation. A lot of his ideas, which were not available at all. The whole, before presenting his theory of special relativity and general relativity, he said the ideas came from my travels. If you look at the history, you will find out. Similarly, so many modern physicists are going to India to see what are these mystics doing, these gurus are doing, and talking about transcendental things, talking about things that are beyond the mind, to understand, will this stand a chance in physics, in science? So it's interesting development going on, and you will be witness to some of these interesting things. I have seen only part of it in my time, but you younger people will see a lot more. Why am I bringing this up is because we have a means to find answers to this question, definite answers, convincing answers, answers to our complete satisfaction, answers that satisfy us completely by just going within ourselves. That's the teaching of great master Baba Sawan Singh. And we are celebrating this fact that such human beings are available. They do come in this world. That such human beings, totally ordinary human beings, with an awareness that is very deep and goes to true knowledge, and they have the knowledge of the truth, which many of us want to have. we are seeking the same knowledge that they are possessing, and they come into our life as part of our own experiences. We can't find them. I am convinced we cannot find a perfect living master, because he's too ordinary to be found. If he wore a badge or something, written PLM or something, we will doubt that anybody can put on that badge. If he puts on special robes, that's a little more impressive than a badge. Well, people put on some robes, saffron-colored robes. I met some Swamis once going on a pilgrimage in India. I said, "Swamis, why are you wearing these robes? You are going on pilgrimage. What's the use of wearing saffron-colored robes, these orange-colored robes you are wearing?" They said, "Our guru told us." I said, "Why did the guru suggest this particular color?" "We don't know." I said, "I'll check with your guru. Why suggesting that he should put saffron?" I checked the gurus of these swamis, and they said they did not know that this color represents the color of fire. It's a reminder 24/7. When you wear that color on your skin, this body will go into fire. You'll be cremated one day. Don't take it as real. And if your own body is not real, no other body is real. There is no reality outside. Find reality somewhere else. It's not in this body which you're thinking is real. They are supposed to be a reminder. But the Swamis were taking their body very real. We totally forgot. They have a festival in India. Recently they had called the Kumbh Mela. It takes place after a long time, sometimes on eclipses of the sun, sometimes on other occasions. And all kinds of swamis come, white colored. Why? We believe in purity. Is your mind pure? Well, no, our clothes are pure. They are white. Some wearing blue color. Where do you find this blue color? It's also a spiritual color. Oh, we heard love is a blue color. We see blue. Blue is the extreme of the other spectrum. So we wear blue color. And then lots of them are moving with no colors. Color of their skin. And all they have on it is ash. If you ask them, why are you wearing ash on your skin? Well, our guru told us. Ask the guru, why do you tell them? To remind them this will turn into ash one day. Don't take it as real. The message is so clear, and the people following this, creating religions out of it, creating so many societies of different kind of it, so many ashrams are created out of it, and none of them understanding why they are doing these things. It's only to show this is not real. It's a projection. Go to the reality, find out. And they are also told, meditation is the way. But meditation, what does meditation mean? To meditate is to meditate upon something. Meditation, nothing more than thinking about something. When you think about something seriously, meditation, think carelessly, then it's not meditation. But serious thinking on something in your head is meditation. We are constantly meditating on our problems, meditating on our relationships outside, meditating upon our profits and losses, meditating upon our health, meditating upon the medicines we have to take, medicine about the food we have to eat, meditation about everything outside. Why don't we meditate once in a while, at least, about insight? Why not meditate? Where am I meditating from? Why not meditate? Who is meditating? Why not meditate upon these deeper questions, which are our questions which you are asking outside? The questions we are asking, what is real? What is truth? And we are looking for that answer in libraries and books and seminars and workshops at Bhandaras. We're looking and going somewhere out to find it. And all the answers are lying inside. Why don't we go inside and check where we are asking questions from? These are very simple questions. Where are we asking this question from? Where are we putting attention from? Where is attention flowing from? If we ask these questions and try to go inside, we just shut off the experience outside for a while. We close our eyes, if necessary, close our ears, go close our whole body with a blanket, sit in darkness and say, now what can I see? We start from there and go further inside whatever we feel is ourself. Look at the simplicity of this method. Whatever we feel is ourself, the thinking self, the self that's asking questions. If we just not look at the cover of the body, this body or the body of self-perception or even the body of thoughts, when we go within that, we get all the answers to all the questions. Spiritual truths can be found merely by a simple method of going within each layer of yourself. You know the outermost layer is the physical body. You can close eyes and forget the physical body as best as you can. An easy method is to concentrate your attention inside. It's a great gift. Somebody asked me, what's the greatest gift given to human beings? I said, the greatest gifts that I found are imagination, attention, power of concentrating attention. These three things can give you all the answers to all your questions. And we all have it. We all have these great gifts given to us that we can imagine, which means we can be non-dependent on physical perceptions. We can concentrate attention. We have attention to put on anything we like. And the power of attention is so beautiful. Supposing I put my attention on these beautiful flowers once again, and I begin to put attention on each flower attentively, what will happen? When I put more attention, it concentrates my attention there and I become less attentive to what is outside, behind that. This ability that you can use your attention by concentrating and fixing it on one thing and becoming unaware of others. The unawareness is more important than the awareness. Because right now, our attention is scattered. We are sitting here. Where is our attention? First, in this hall where this meeting is taking place. Secondly, sometimes we remember things which are outside. Did I park my car in the right place? Or did I get a ticket for the car? Attention can go there. When I left home, I didn't leave. Did I leave the kitchen stove on or not? I'm worried about it. Okay. All kinds of things, our attention is scattered. We are continuously thinking one or the other things, and it's all different places, moment to moment, spreading itself out. If I start concentrating on flowers, I can't be thinking of those at the same time. The more you concentrate on something, the less aware you become of the others. If you concentrate your attention on your imaginative self inside your head, you become unaware of this world and you become unaware even of this body. And you become more aware, very strongly aware, that what you think is imaginative is much more real because it's yourself is still in that body, not in this anymore. The self is important. Where do you feel is yourself? When we go to sleep at night, there's a dream body we have. It's not this body. This body is sleeping on the bed. Dream body is a separate body. We take on a new body. Sometimes not exactly looking like this one. Sometimes younger, sometimes older, sometimes different form altogether. But we know that's our body, my body. The self is the same. The self that is a dream body is the same self that was there in the sleeping body. It has not changed at all. We are not seeing somebody else moving around. We are moving around in a dream. The same self. Similarly, in imagination, the same self. We go to a higher level where everything disappears, same self is having the disappearance. The self never changes. The self is the only reality. The rest are just created around it. And if we go that deep level of discovering the immortality of the self, the non-destructibility of the self, that no matter where you are, the self remains the same. If you examine that, then you understand that what you think is yourself is merely a cover upon the self. You can understand the physical cover very easily, that you are thinking inside, you are questioning inside, you are conscious inside, is just a cover. Imaginative self also becomes a cover. The mental self that thinks becomes a cover when you go to that level. But beyond that, we cannot go. As human beings, using our minds, that's a limit we can reach. The limit is to discover our own minds and the reality of the mind in which self is hidden. Why can't we go beyond that? Somebody wrote to me an interesting question. He said that he was initiated by an Indian master. And that master told him that there are sounds at every level till our true home. There are sounds which are physical sounds, and then there are sounds that are astral sounds which can be heard without these ears, but they ring inside. And we hear bell sound, we can hear conch sound, we can hear those sounds. He listed the names of the sounds, explained to that young disciple at the time of initiation. And then the sounds keep on changing, and then there are sounds which take place at the mind level, then there are sounds at the soul level, then there are sounds at the truth, ultimate self level, which is our true home. He said he heard one of my talks in which I said that sound ends much earlier and it cannot be heard because there is no time and space there. Sound that we know of is only possible in time and space, and time and space ends in the causal region, at the mental region. Therefore, there is no sound. He says, how are you explaining this when we can hear a higher sound and go to our true home? Very good question. The reality is that what we call sound has been written by many people. It's mentioned in the Bible, in John's Gospel. In the beginning was the Word. He doesn't say in the beginning was God. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. These are the opening sentences of John's Gospel. Rig Veda, in the Indian Vedas, out of four Vedas, the one that deals with creation, says the nad, the sound, was the creative power that created everything. In more modern times, in the Sikh literature, the Guru Granth Sahib, it says, Shabde dharti, shabde kaash, shabde shabd vyapar kaash, shabd created this sky and the earth, and shabd created shabd itself. The sound created all this. These words, shabd, word, sound, nad, what is common in all these? They can all be heard. They're audible. That's what's common. They are saying something audible is creating the universe. How is it possible? What we know of sound is a sound that occurs in time and space here. You take space away in vacuum, there is no sound. How can sound create the universe? And why are all these people saying sound created the universe? Even this major question about the sound can only be answered if you go within. The word sound has been used, the word word has been used, the word shabd has been used, the word nad has been used, the word nam has been used. All these different words have been used representing something audible. Because ourself, which is the ultimate destination, which is the discovery we want to make, which is always with us, no matter what, whether we are dreaming, whether we are awake, whether we are further awake, whether we are in our true home, the self is always there, same self. And that self in the physical plane can be heard, is audible. That's the secret. That if you want to go move towards the self, you can hear it. It's a very strange experience. That the self which is conscious, which is consciousness itself, which is conscious of everything, therefore aware of everything, can be heard in the physical plane. And we are talking of a spiritual journey starting from the physical plane. Therefore, masters have come down to explain things in physical terms throughout. Because there is no explanation, we have no concept available, no mental capacity available to describe anything beyond time and space. Reality lies beyond time and space, there is no description for it. I've never seen any description, nor am I able to describe anything beyond it. Therefore, all the masters teaching us something at the starting point, as physical human beings, teaching other physical human beings in a physical universe, are using physical examples for everything. So when they say that the sound can take you up all the way, they are defining sound in different ways at different levels. It looks sound, the word sound has been used, the word has been used because we are starting point is physical universe. We start with physical bodies and physical meditation, physically going inside, having physical experiences. Therefore, first step, try to hear the sound of your own self, which is a physical sound. Same sound like we hear outside. You ring the bell outside, you can hear the bell with these ears. Close your ears. Listen, put your attention on the self. Which self? Your own self. Wherever you feel it is, no matter what. Concentrate your attention. You'll hear the sound of the self with your ears closed. There, you may hear other sounds too. People do hear other sounds coming from physical sources. You can start hearing your heartbeat. You can hear your breathing. You can hear gurgling in the belly. You can also hear the blood flowing. The more concentrated you are, the more your capacity for listening to very minor sounds comes up. You can hear many kinds of sounds. But when the sound comes from the very place from where you are trying to hear the sound, when it comes to the center of your own self, it's a sound that emanates from yourself and you try to find which direction it comes from. It comes from every direction. It resembles the sound of a big bell to start with. Therefore, we call it the sound of a bell. Now to say that ringing a bell is going to give you spiritual benefit is no good. We are talking of a physical experience that is possible at a physical level of trying to put yourself behind the eyes where you feel yourself is and listening to your own self. And the more concentrated your attention is on yourself, the clearer the sound will be of the self. You can distinguish it from the other sounds. Some sounds are disturbing. People have problems in the ear. They call it tinnitus, something like this. And they are very disturbing sound. It bothers them. But the sound of the self, nothing that bothers. It's so melodious. It's a melody coming from, like ringing through space. Like it's all around you. And you don't know where it's emanating from, because emanating from you, you're not used to that. You're always used to sound coming from your sides. And here is a sound coming from the self. It takes time to realize where it's coming from. And that sound, when you listen to it, you are pulling yourself to your own self. That is why it's a great method to use the sound of the self to pull yourself to the reality of your own self. But what happens if you are able to pull it more and forget what's happening outside? Next step. The sound becomes different. The sound seems to be a very long stretch of one sound, not that bell-like sound with up and down of a bell sound. It changes. They say it becomes like a conch sound. The conch blows straight, there is no bell sound in it. Same bell sound, looks like a conch sound. Because we have now moved on to our imaginative self or astral self or self of sense perceptions with no awareness of our physical body. What happens if you go further? If you go within the head of your astral self, of your imaginary self, what happened to the sound? Sound is still there. Space and time is still there. But the sound becomes like you have been listening to that sound all the time. You don't feel you just entered to hear the sound. You go there, you are always listening to it. And then you come back, you don't know what happened. This strange experience of the sound at the third level, physical, astral, what we call the causal or mental level, that sound is a continuous sound. And we don't feel it's continuous, we feel we have been listening to it all the time. That's a very big experience. Totally unknown in the physical plane, totally unknown in the astral plane, and you have that experience inside by concentrating your attention on your own self beyond the astral self. We still call it the sound. But when we analyze these sounds and see what the writers who analyze the sounds have said about it, they give different names to these sounds. Use the word shabd. Shabd can be a word, shabd can be a sound. We sing shabds, we write shabd. So therefore, let's see the word shabd. What do they call the first shabd? It's a spoken word, written word. It's not something extraordinary. We are using it all the time. We are speaking with that, we are hearing with that. So, we call it something that can be spoken, written, expressed. We call it in Indian languages, we call it varanatmak shabd. Varanatmak, which can be varnan, which can be explained, can be spoken, can be written. Varanatmak shabd I'm using now to speak to you. You are using your ears to hear the varanatmak shabd. What happens when it goes inside and becomes that musical sound? They're not using any words there. Even a bell is not a word. The sound of the bell is not a word. Bell is a word. But when we hear that inner sound, it's not words, but still a melody, a dhun. So we change the language to describe that sound. In the literature, they say it's not varanatmak shabd anymore. It's become dhun atmak shabd. The word atmak is being used as reference to the atma or the self. It's our self. It's our sound. But we are hearing it. And it's varanatmak. We are hearing it with the ears. Dhun atmak. We are hearing with our imagination, inside, in meditation. What happens after that? After that, the sound becomes continuous. We give it a different name. We call it anhad shabd. What does anhad means? No boundaries. It's not a name given just for the sake of a name. It's a name given by an actual experience you get. And people who gave this name, named it after an experience. You really feel you are experiencing a sound with no beginning, no end. It's been going on forever. Name has changed. Sound has changed. Now space and time end there. What do you call the shabd after that? If you can go beyond, which you can, and I'll explain to you how you can go beyond even your own efforts, beyond your mind. If you go beyond that, the same sound, same shabd is called sar shabd, real sound. Were there not other real sounds? They were real sounds, but they were sounds. When we say real sounds, sar shabd, we are referring to the reality of what it is, and that is the name given to our own soul. Our individuated consciousness evolves the shabd all the time. First time we discover it's not a sound at all. It's our own self or conscious self that has been called a sound, because all the time the lower sounds were taking us to that sound, to that reality of our own self. We can go beyond to totality, because the sar shabd shows our true nature is a unit of consciousness, our soul. What is the reality of a soul then? Can we go beyond that? Not many people have gone beyond that. Not many masters exist. Masters who have reached the discovery of the soul, which is immortal. They've discovered that unit of consciousness we call soul is immortal, has always existed. They've been called sadgurus. And then we distinguish from satgurus, who we say go beyond that. When they go beyond that, they discover that there is a totality of consciousness, not units of consciousness. Totality is very different from units. Totality is the creative power from which everything, the units and the experience of units have been created. It can be experienced, and I'll tell you how, but it is only done when you discover that the name of the sound is changed. And from sar shabd, they say you go to sat shabd, true sound. These are names given to a sound which is not a sound at all at that stage. So when masters have given descriptions, they have used all physical analogies to describe them. Seth Shivdyal Singh, Swamiji we call him of Agra. He started, or they so say, on his name they started the Radha Swami faith. He describes a stage without time and space, a stage where nothing can be known to us through imagination or thinking at all. He describes there are tall trees there, several miles high, laden with jewelry. Diamonds and rubies are laden on it. And he described our true home, totality of consciousness, beyond time and space, having trees with all these things, just big ones. Some of his followers have described the light of several trillion suns is this, and several quadrillion suns is this, described just the vastness of light. All physical terminology. Why? There's no terminology available to describe anything beyond space and time. So all the masters have described these sounds are like these tones of sounds are there. These are all for our physical use here to make a start and go in and see the real thing. Real thing cannot be described, so you just go in and experience it. But we want to know, tell us something about it, and they make stories. I make a lot of stories too. But they are stories. There is no way to describe the reality, so we use analogies. That's why I want to make clear to people who have this misgiving that the sound remains the same sound, that the colors remain the same colors, the skies remain the same skies, they're all changing and the experience is totally different. Most people talk about these things without experience. When they have experience, they can't say those things. Their mouth is shut. It's not describable. There's a saint called Bhika. He says in Hindi, Bhika baat agam ki, kahen sunan mein nahi, jo jane so kahe na, jo kahe so jane nahi. Bhika, the state of that awareness cannot be described. Those who describe it haven't known it. And those who have known it don't describe it. So when people start describing these things, they are saying something which is not true. But we cannot understand the truth by just simple words over here. So that is why All these analogies are being used, stories are being made, so that we make a start and go and see what is inside our own self. How can we go beyond the mind? Is it possible? Great Master 31Mar2019 told us how we can go to the totality of consciousness, to our true home, which is beyond our effort, beyond the capacity of our minds, beyond the capacity of all thoughts. And I'll share with you that secret in today's afternoon meeting. It's always good to leave something so that you all come back in the afternoon. Thank you very much for patiently listening to me. We'll take a break now, and I'll be back about 3 o'clock again and share with you the secret of going beyond the mind to our totality.